Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
And so I'm going to get down on my knees and I'm going to pray. I need God. You say, Pastor, you're going to get down on your knees. We haven't seen you on your knees in a long time. Well, I'm jazzed tonight. Here's what I ask of you. If you give me a favor, would you do me a favor? If I get down on my knees and don't get back up, would you help me back up? That would be really good, okay? But come on, let's go before the Lord. Let's pray tonight, because we're not going to get anything done without God being in the house and God doing the work. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord. We're grateful people tonight, Lord. But we're wise enough to know that we haven't come into the house of God to hear from a man. We haven't come to hear from a woman. We haven't come to hear from a black man, a white man, a brown man, or anything else. Lord, we have come to hear from the teacher of the church, who is the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, give you all the glory, give you all the honor. We're so honored, Lord. Now, Lord, we would have you bless us tonight, of course, and we're asking for that. But we would also have you bless all the churches in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Will you bless our Baptist brothers and Lutherans and Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals, Lord? We thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, and Oak Valley and Oasis and Inland Christian Center. We thank you, Father, for the Assemblies of God, the Foursquare. How about our Adventist brothers and sisters and our Catholic brothers and sisters? Lord, they're your people, not mine. I'm asking you to bless them, Father, as you would bless us, and God will give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, everybody say amen. So good. I want to just share some principles that God gave me about this tonight, about for all of us, if you really want to know the truth. I love the Word of God when it fits all of us every day. We can use the Word of God on about everything. I find that people who live by the Word of God are very prosperous. And I find that people who do not live by the Word of God are not very prosperous, frustrated, discouraged. You'll find their lives are out of sync. Their families are in disarray. And so living by the Word of God is very important. And you've heard people say that to you all your life. But sometimes we just don't realize how simple it is to follow the things of God. Tonight, I just want to share with you a little basic principle, just something that I found out as an old man that I found out really does work. And it's so simple, yet so profound. Let me make a statement to you, if I may. What would it be like if I said to you that we could share something so simple with you tonight that you can apply it easily in your life? And not only apply it in your life, if you do, you're gonna get blessed, your family's gonna get blessed, your children and your children's children's gonna get blessed. Isn't that good? I mean, if I could say something simple, sometimes we come into the house of God and we're looking for something that's so deep and so mystical and so, you know, so out there that it's hard to believe, hard to apply. But this is so simple tonight. In fact, what I'm gonna share with you is a thread that goes through every successful person's life in the Bible. If you find someone in the Bible that is successful, like whoever it might possibly be, Joseph, you want to think about Joseph for a moment, you want to think about David for a moment, Elijah and Elisha for a moment, Jeremiah, well, whoever it might be. And then you go jumping over the New Testament, Peter, Paul, James, John, all the people that are there, just magnificent, just wonderful things. There is one common thread through every person in the Bible that is successful. And that's such a simple principle I wanted to share with you tonight. It's the principle, literally, of faithfulness. One thing I can say to you is that God is looking for people who are faithful. It doesn't sound very exciting. It's not one of those messages you kind of jump up and shout. But there's a divine law that is attached to faithfulness. A divine law. God looks for people who will simply, their yes is yes and their no is no. And my goodness, I found out something that is so important for all of us. I found out that God's not only looking for people who are faithful, but God really uses people who are faithful. And I found out, listen to this, I like this part. God really blesses the people and their families that are faithful. Isn't it a simple thought just somebody that's going to say yes to something and stick with their yes. And someone says, well, I was faithful for a little while, but I wasn't faithful for very long. Can I tell you something? Faithfulness has nothing to do with timing. It has to do with whether or not your heart's going to stay in where it needs to be and be there for a long period of time. I've known so many people over the years. They may not be the greatest scholars. They may not know the Greek and the Hebrew. May not have the greatest insight in the Word of God. But one thing you could do, you can count on them. When they say something, wow, it's going to be there. They're going to follow through with it. And I wanted to just share with you four little things tonight that you can write down, you can apply in your life on an everyday basis. I love that part. And listen to this. And you can do something with it. You can use it for the betterment of your family, your home, your children, finances, dream, vision, whatever it is. Just four little principles about faithfulness. Is that okay? I could give you 40. But I don't think you'd like me after 40, so I'll give you four. Is that okay? And if you can remember just a couple of these four, you're going to get blessed and you'll start to remember these things. Number one, I wanted to mention to you is this, is that things to know about faithfulness. Number one, God is our example of faithfulness. As an old man, I've been serving the Lord for a lot of years. We go back a long time, a lot of messages. We've preached a lot of things, read a lot of Greek, read a lot of Hebrew. I mean, just really got into the Word of God. Debbie and I were so devastated as young people. We didn't have anything. We didn't know how we were going to make it. You know, when we first got married, I'd lost my job right off the bat. God had a plan. I couldn't figure out what his plan was. Anybody ever been there? God has a plan, but you sure as heck can't figure it out. Well, that's where I was. And Debbie, we didn't know where we were going, what we're doing, how we're going to make it. And one of the things that we found out is that after all of these years, I can look back and tell you one thing that God, here's one thing that I know for sure, that God is a faithful God. He doesn't run off and forget me. He doesn't make a promise to me and not fulfill that promise. In fact, God made promises and has made promises to all of us. And you know what? He wants to fulfill those promises. Actually, he's waiting for us to get in the right position in order to get those promises fulfilled. Because God is a faithful God. I tell you, as older I get, the more I get a joy out of the fact that my example in life is the greatness of God and his faithfulness. He's a God that's there when I needed him. He's a God that was there when I needed him to heal me. He was a God that spoke to me. Even though horrible tragedies have happened in people's lives, I've seen him come through and heal the people. I've seen him take care of and open the eyes. I've seen him get the lame walking. I've seen him do great, mighty, marvelous miracles. I'm talking about a miracle-working God. Can you imagine this? That is faithful. He's faithful to his promises. He's faithful to his word. He's faithful to you. He's faithful in his love. I don't know about you, but I've met a lot of people that aren't faithful. I think I've married a couple of them along the road when I was a young man. You know what I'm talking about, some of you. You know, they make all kinds of promises to you, and then all of a sudden, oh my goodness, they're gone. They ran off with somebody else or did something else. And it's just like the craziest thing in the world. We have a whole world in our life of people who are not faithful as examples, but there's one you can put your heart on. There's one you can know assuredly. There's one you can go to the bank on. I want you to know something. You remember the bank, the Security Pacific? Does anybody ever remember? Raise your hand if you remember it. Where is Security? How about Mutual? What was it called? Washington Mutual. Whatever happened to Washington Mutual? Come on. Here's one you can go to the bank on. His name is Jesus Christ. He is a faithful God who loves you. He's there in tough times, and he's there. He's there for you all the time. I love the Word of God. I'm just going to pop it up on the overhead for you. Deuteronomy 7 chapter and verse number 9 is kind of cool. Let's take a look at it together. And it says, therefore, know. You know, when the Bible makes a statement like, know, I better know something. God wants me to get it down on the inside. He doesn't want me just to flippantly forget about it. He doesn't want me just to look the other way. He says these words, therefore. In other words, there's something you ought to know, and you and I ought to know something. Know that the Lord your God, he is. Can somebody say that next word? He's who? He's God. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. The faithful God who keeps covenant mercy for us. And I love this next part. Listen to this. 1,000 generations. You know, I'm part of that 1,000 generations. That God hadn't looked the other way because it was in those days that he made it. He is faithful to 1,000 generations. You're in that 1,000. Your children's children are in that 1,000 generation. God hasn't gone away. God hasn't gone to the other side. God hasn't taken a vacation, you know, here today and gone to Maui. Let me tell you something about God. God is here and he remembered to 1,000 generations. You can know that God is a faithful God. You can put your heart in God. You can trust God. He wants to do great, mighty things. I love that 1,000 generation to those, but here's a catch to it, to those who love him and keep his commandments. Can I just ask a question? Is there a catch 22? Does anybody know what I mean by a catch 22? In other words, here's the promise, but here's also the thing that has to go along with it. And there's got to be some relationship of love, isn't there? And there's got to be a wanting and a desire to keep his commandments. You can't just keep living your life. You can't live your way and all that kind of stuff and expect him to be faithful to you. In other words, if you're not faithful to him, he's not faithful to you. And a lot of people get frustrated with God. They say, oh my goodness, what about God? He allowed this, he allowed that. He could have stopped that. He could have stopped that. Did you ever stop and think about what kind of a condition the world is that he could have stopped? Oh my goodness, were they faithful to him? Were they keeping his covenant? Were they people of loving him? Of course not. Therefore, there's no responsibility for God to be faithful. But if you're somebody who loves God, how easy is that? And somebody who learns what he says and start applying it in your life to the best of your ability, he'll be faithful to you. Somebody ought to give the Lord a great big praise. Isn't that a cool thing? I love this verse in 1 Kings 8th chapter, verse number 56. And here we find just pop it up, in 1 Kings. Blessed be the Lord who has given rest to his people Israel according to all that he promised. Listen, when there's a promise of God, sometimes we stop and we question it. We say, I hear it, I know the promise, but I don't feel it. I don't see it on the inside. I'm not sure he's really there. I'm not sure he's coming through. Listen to what he says, and this hasn't changed at all. There's to his people, he promised, there has not, listen to this, failed one word of his good promises, which he promised through his servant Moses. And you can look back at thousands of years and not one word has ever failed. Someone says, I don't know if there's a God. Come on, we have a book of thousands of years of example, prophetic utterance that has been there, that it proves that God is faithful. What he said, he will do. He will love those that love him. He'll draw near to you if you, come on, draw near to him. Come on, somebody. So our example right off the bat every single day is the faithfulness of our God himself. And he's looking for a people like you and I to be faithful also. Number two, let's take a look at this. I like this because we're talking about things to know about faithfulness. Number two, faith, I love this. Faithfulness is tested with the small things. And really, faithfulness is developed in the small things. The Bible makes it very clear, don't despise the big, small beginnings. But you know, sometimes we're gonna see how faithful we are by what we do. And God's looking at just the very small things oftentimes that no one's around, no one sees, no one really ever considers whatsoever. These small things are so important. I was meditating this and I thought about David. Here he is. He's with his dad. You've heard me tell this story before, with his dad's sheep on the hills of Judea. You know, and the hills of Judea are just outside of Jerusalem. It kind of shows how wealthy his family was because that's a prime grazing land right outside of Jerusalem. It sells on the hills of Judea. And he's with the sheep. I don't know if you've ever been around sheep, but his dad's got a lot of sheep. And you stop and you think about, first of all, he's the youngest and maybe he's been picked on by his brothers. You could see that obviously in scripture that they put him down on a big scale. And here's David out there watching the sheep and he is faithful to tend these sheep. You know, sometimes if I was out there, I might not tend the sheep very good. How about you? Those little things go around, get themselves stuck in creeks, get themselves stuck in little briar bushes. They're never staying where they need to stay. They drink lousy water. They get sick all the time. And here's David. He's watching these sheep. And his dad's got a lot of them. And here comes the lion and the bear. And I love this story because I can just picture it with all of my heart. Here's a lion and bear coming in. They're coming in at night, you know, to prey upon the little lambs and the little sheep. Well, if a lion came in and you and I were out there and my daddy had a lot of sheep, we'd probably both agree, let the lion have the sheep. Dad will never know. Who gives a big flip, you know? Here comes a bear. Let him have one too. Just leave the rest of us. That way, tonight we'll have some peace. They're going to come and go. But he doesn't. The Bible says he grabs a hold of that lion by its beard. Man, and he kills that lion and he kills that bear. He will not let his dad lose that little sheep. That's faithfulness. You know, when he fought that battle, don't you know he caught the eyes of God, caught the heart of God? And God had seen him as the future one. If he'd be faithful to those little things of taking care of the sheep, he would be somebody who'll take care of Israel. Oh, oftentimes we don't know about the little things. We pass on the little things. We get discouraged. We see them as unimportant, my friends. And when you see something as unimportant because it's little, let me tell you something, that's what God's looking for, is somebody who will take care of the little things in life. It's those little things. Oftentimes, some people can't even go to church on a regular basis. They go for a few weeks and then they stop and then they go for a few weeks. You can't count on them for anything. They sign up for something and don't come and, you know, they complain about this and complain about that. And we've all experienced people like that. Just the little things. Some people make commitments at the beginning of the year saying, this year I'm going to tithe. And they can't even keep that past January. All of a sudden, things arise. But it's those little things in your heart that you just fight through, that you keep going. It's important. Never see something little as something little. It's a big thing to see whether or not you're going to accomplish it through faithfulness. And then God will give you the bigger things. And so oftentimes we want the big things, important things, before we're faithful on the little things. And God tests us in the little things, doesn't he? It's those things that you don't think much about, that you maybe no one can see, especially in the wee hours at night when God spoke to you and said, I want you to get up and pray. I hate it when God tells me to get up and pray in the middle of the night. I mean, I always say, Lord, talk to Debbie. And, you know, I do. And I'm just bad about that. And all for years and years and decades, I've heard the woman up praying all night long. And I'm saying, God, listen to her prayer as I roll over, you know. And it's the little things that really we miss out on oftentimes. And God would have us to realize that. It's so important for us to see. Listen to what it says in Luke 19th chapter, verse 17. It says this. And he said to him, well done, good servant. Because you were faithful in the very little, listen to this, have authority over 10 cities. Before you get the big, you got to learn to be faithful in the little. Let me say it again. Before you get the big, you got to be faithful in the little. The other day I was out at the food lines and I saw how many people were there. I remember when we started the food lines. I didn't start the food lines. I wasn't spiritual enough to be in the food lines, to start the food lines. My wife, Debbie, she had a pickup truck. I had a little blue pickup truck. And a couple of girls from the church, they'd get together and they would have bags of rice and bags of beans. And they would go. I mean, she would go downtown San Bernardino. I'm talking about the ghetto part of San Bernardino. Today you go down there, you're dead. And she'd go down there and she'd knock on all the doors, her and these other girls. And I would say, oh, Lord, man, I got to get an insurance policy on that woman because I need to have some money if you're going to take her home. And so that's where I was at. You know what I mean? Help me. Somebody pray for me. And so she's down there, and that's how this food ministry started, literally passing out beans. And she'd go door to door and say, you want some? We have rice and beans. That's all we had. That's all the money we could afford. We had like, you know, 20 bucks a month. So we'd go get free rice and free beans, and we'd go knock on doors. I say we because she's me. I did it through her. You remember how the Bible says we're one flesh? And so the woman's side of me went down there and she would knock on the doors and they'd come out and she'd give them rice and beans. She said, if you want to ride to church, we'll pick you up. That's how we started this. And all of a sudden, I see the bus ministry picks up 26,000 people. I see the food ministry feeding thousands of people. And we don't just feed people, my friends. I mean, they have carts full of food. They got stuff. These people are dragging food like this out of the place. And I'm thinking, man, God, they're in worse shape than me. And they got a bigger bag than I could ever handle. It's amazing. If you're not small, if you're not faithful in the small, you'll never get the big. Can I say something? It's the same thing with finances. If you're not faithful in the small things, to do the things that are right, then don't expect to ever get control of or have blessings in the big things in finances. The Bible makes it very clear. If you can't even handle the little things, you'll never get the big things. Third point for tonight. Are you okay with me? Are you all right? And I'd have better, I'm really insecure. Are you all right with me?
Yeah.
Okay, third thing tonight, I like this one. Things to know about faithfulness. Faithfulness brings pleasure to God and blessings to your family. Now just stop and think about that. Everybody in this room wants to be blessed. If I asked you, anybody in here that doesn't, don't raise your hand. Anybody in here that doesn't want to be blessed and you raised your hand, we'd have to cast the devil out of you right after church service. Because you would not only be dumb, you'd be filled with the devil with stupidity. And I believe this, all of us want to be blessed and we want to please God. I don't know about you, but I think about it all the time. I'd like to be pleasing to God. You know, I'd like to be that guy that gets up in the middle of the night and prays with her, with his wife. Will you pray for me so that I could do that? When I hear her praying, I'll get up and pray with her. I snore with her. She says, "Are you praying?" I said, "Yes." I'm through my nose. Some people pray in tongues. I pray in nose. And so, you didn't get that, did you? You don't have any idea what I'm talking about. But anyway, here's the truth about these things. If we're going to please God, it's so important for us to realize that faithfulness is something that God's looking for. It's so easy for us to quit. It's so easy for us to give up. It's so easy for us to stop. It's more comfortable. It feels better. But guess what? In order to please God, in order for you to get your families blessed and you know you want it, you're going to have to learn, and so am I, to be faithful in these little things that God has brought to our life. In Exodus, the 19th chapter, in verse number 5, watch this, check it out. Exodus, the 19th chapter, verse number 5. I love this word. I taught you this before. The biggest little word in the Bible. Does anybody remember what the biggest little word in the Bible is? Could you tell me?
Yes.
Okay, now watch this. Now, it says, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. So he comes along and says, if you do this, now someone says, well, where's the word faithfulness in there? It's in your doing. It's in your if part. If you do what you say, if you indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then he comes along. You'll be you're not a special treasure until you start realizing how important it is for us to be faithful to the things of God. Very important for us. What good is it if you're not faithful to the things of the Lord? And we'll never be faithful to the things of the Lord if we haven't even practiced being faithful to the things of this planet. We ought to be able to be faithful to something. Make a commitment, stick with a commitment. Yes, even if it hurts. The Bible says that you swear to your own hurts at times. In other words, you're making a commitment to something. You don't want to do it, but you keep on doing it. It's in those times that it becomes blessings to God. I don't want to read my Bible. I don't want to study. I don't want to go to church again. This is maybe the second time in a week that I've gone to church. Some of you used to go to church 2-3 times a week. You're cooling off, and now you're only coming once a week. And you know something? You used to go all the time, but it's in those little faithful things that you do that open the door to pleasure God and bring you to a place of being a treasure before his eyes so that you get blessed. God's good. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Fourth thing I want to share with you about things to know about the faithfulness of God and the faithfulness that he requires of us is number 4. You got to get this one. Unfaithful people fail. Just as simple as that. They just don't make it. Unfaithful people are people who say yes to one thing and give up something else. You know, I want to tell you the story of, you've heard it a million times, but let me share it with you just one more time, of the children of Israel. They're coming out of the bondage for 400 years with the Egyptian. You know the story. And God wants to take them in to a place of blessing. The story is not about Israel. The story is not about them coming out of bondage. The story is about you. And the story is about me. We were in bondage. And God wants us to come out of the bondage and go into our promised land. The one thing about Israel is they knew that God was going to provide for them. They had heard about it for hundreds of years. The promised land was theirs. And when it came time for them to take it, they went in to the promised land as spies, 12 spies, and you know the story, how they went in and they came back and 10 of the 12 said, "No, we can't do this. We're but grasshoppers in our own eyes and in their eyes, and we can't make it." And that which God wanted to bless them for, they failed at accomplishing. God wants to take you to your personal promised land. Can you imagine such a thing? But if you refuse to go into Canaan land, you refuse to go into the promised land because it looks tough or it's hard or there's giants in the land or there's problems or obstacles and you don't know how to make it, it doesn't seem logical, it's just not going to be there. Can I tell you something? Your faithfulness will be tried and tried, and you'll never get to the place where you want to be until you are faithful in the things of God. They had to wait until the entire generation died off. And in the next generation, they come up and they get into the promised land, and it's everything God promised them it would be. Guys, can I just say something to you? Tonight, we're looking at this simple message about being faithful. A simple message. God wants you to go into your personal promised land. That's the desires that are inside of your heart. They're not there by mistake. God planted them in there. It's the freedom that you've experienced that you see. It's the taste that you know that it's ahead of you. You can see yourself entering into that particular spot. And God wants to take you there. But if you refuse to be faithful, you refuse to adhere to what he has to say, you refuse to go forward and back off because of the problems that are set before you, you will never make it. I want you to hear old grandpa for just a moment, because you never had grandpa ever tell you anything. Here's a grandpa telling you something. So let me be your grandpa just for a moment. And I want you to hear what I'm about to say. You will never do anything great in your life without resistance, without something coming against you, without a fight, without a war, without something trying to stop you. But I'm here to tell you something. When you're faithful to what God has said, when you're faithful to what God has committed, when you're faithful to the dream, the vision that God has dropped on the inside of you, when you're faithful to those things and you're not going to back off, you're like a bulldog with a piece of meat. I'm here to tell you something. Get ready. It's around the corner. But I want you to know something. You and I are called by God to be faithful. Without that, my friends, none of us make it. Joseph, what if he had given up halfway? What if he had gone off with Potiphar's wife? You know, she wanted a him. And he said, "I will not sin." You know what that means. We're in church. If we weren't in church, we could say something else. But we're in church. We won't say that. But let me just say this to you. Listen, what if he didn't, when he remained not faithful to God? Would he have ever become the prime minister of the entire world and control the things that he had ahead of him? He had years and years and years of problems and pressures ahead of him, and yet he had a great ending with great things taking place. What about David if he was running from Saul and he decided, "I've had enough"? And David did have a few times when in moments that he had enough. He'd even climbed into a cave and there he was lost and found himself as a leader of a tribe of a bunch of losers. But yet at the same time, David finally gets to the place where he strengthens himself in the things of God, gets back in line. Some of you have not been faithful, but it's not too late to strengthen yourself in God, get back to where you need to be, doing what God called you to do, and stop this foolishness of going in the wrong direction, because people who are unfaithful will fail. what would happen in the life of Paul if he said, the ministry is too tough for me. This is crazy. You give me a mandate to preach the gospel to the entire world. I'm ready to do that. I want to tell them about the dispensation of grace. Oh, I'm ready to do that. You've spoken to me about great and mighty and marvelous things. I'm ready to do that. What in the world are you doing throwing me in prison? What are you doing beating my back? This is a lousy, lousy ministry you've given me and complain. Unfaithful people fail. Paul was successful writing 2/3 of the New Testament. His writings to this day are read by more people on this planet than any other writing that there's ever been. Right now, today, more people read him than anybody else on the planet. Why? Because he was faithful in those tough times. Will you have tough times? You better believe you're going to have tough times. But I got good news for you. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Listen to me. I got good news here. All things are possible to him that believes. I got good news from you. Let me tell you something. God's a God that opens doors that no man can open and closes doors. I like those closed doors. That closes doors no man can close. He's a God that cannot, will not, and shall not fail on your behalf. And he's just looking for someone just like you that'll be faithful to the things of God. Come on, somebody, say amen. Woo! Real quick before we leave, I want to ask everybody to remain seated. Nobody get up. Nobody walk around. Could I just get your attention just for a moment? I want to talk to you about something serious. Is that okay? I want to ask you a question all across this place. And I want you to answer the question in your heart. Nobody will know. Is that okay? But you and God. But be fair and be honest with yourself. Nobody will know but you and God. But be honest and answer the question in your heart. Don't just stare at me. Don't just look at me. Answer the question in your heart. Let's talk just for a moment. If you were to walk out to your car and your heart stopped, bang, and you died in the next few minutes, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Someone might say, wait a minute, Pastor Jim, I don't believe in hell, so that's not an issue with me. But can I tell you something? The Bible talks about it in the Old Testament as well as the New Testament. And Jesus himself even speaks about it. Did you know this? Listen to what I'm going to say to you. Even though you don't believe it, doesn't mean it's going to go away. It's still for real. So the question still remains, and it's a valid question and a good question for you tonight. Are you going to go to heaven? Are you going to go to hell? It's a good question. Now let's talk about your answer, because your answer tells you exactly where you're at. Some of you said, well, Pastor Jim, I think I'm going to go to heaven. I think I'm going to make it. Can I tell you something? Listen closely. Listen, listen, listen. Nowhere in the Bible does it say positive thinking gets you to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. It's not in the Bible. You say, wait a minute, Pastor Jim. My answer is different. I'm really a good person. I'm going to go to heaven because I'm good, you know. I haven't done anything bad. It's been a long time since I robbed the local 7-Eleven. San Bernardino. And but guess what? I'm a pretty good person. I'm going to make it to heaven because I'm pretty good. But can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible says you get to go to heaven because you're good. You're just not going to make it. Somebody needs to love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. Listen to me. I love you. I respect you. And I'm honoring you enough to tell you the absolute truth. You can't get to heaven that way. Some of you said to yourself, well, Pastor Jim, I want you to know my mom and dad told me I was a Christian when I was a kid. They put a cross or a St. Christopher around my neck. They took me to catechism class or Sunday school or Sabbath school class when I was a child. They told me I was a Christian all my life. I've always believed myself to be a Christian. But can I say something to you? Nowhere in the Bible does it say, it's not in the Bible, that your mom and dad can tell you you're a Christian and you're a Christian. You get to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. Nope, somebody needs to love you enough to tell you before it's too late. You're not going to make it. The Bible makes it very clear that you can't wear religious jewelry or put a bumper sticker on your car that says Christianity is for me or I'm a Christian and you get to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. And somebody needs to tell you. Jesus makes a statement. Listen to what I'm going to say. He says these words, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. In other words, you can't get to heaven your way. You can't even get to heaven my way. No, you can't get to heaven some well-meaning church committee's way. You're going to have to get to heaven his way. Now here's Jesus. Listen, you know this. A beaten, bloody mess, nailed to the cross for you, raised from the dead on the third day, so that you can go to heaven and have eternal life with him. Wow. And do you think he wouldn't tell you how to get there? That he just leaves it up to you, you know, whatever you think is okay and whatever that group says is okay and whatever those people say is okay, I guess it's okay. No, he doesn't. He's not stupid and he doesn't treat you like you're stupid. He tells you exactly in the scripture how to get to heaven. In fact, here's the verse for you. In John, the third chapter, he says these words, you must be born again. I know that as soon as I say those words, born again, oh my goodness, people turn their brain off, you know, and just, you know, kind of shut down. But don't do that tonight, because born again doesn't mean what Hollywood says it is, or movies or magazines have told you born again people are like. You know, they present born again people like crazy, goofy, and radical, and just nuts as can be. But that's not what the Bible says about being born again. Let me tell you what the Bible says about being born again. Born again means this, and I want you to hear me so you can understand what born again really means. Because did you know most people that attend American churches really don't even know what born again means? Oh my goodness, is that a shock? Let me tell you what it means from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. Here's what it means. It means that you have given God all of your heart and all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Man, it always has been. It's always been all or nothing with Jesus Christ. You can't be a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down. No, it's all or nothing. I'll prove it to you by the scripture. You know, the scripture tells us in the book of Revelation, you've heard of that. It's the last book in the Bible. Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again. And you know he is. And he says, and when I come, I better find you hot. Or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Ugh, what a horrible statement. Listen to it again. If I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you out of my mouth. You're not going to make it lukewarm. Can I define lukewarm for you for a moment? See if this fits. A little in, a little out, a little up, a little down, token prayer, occasional church attendance. You know, you're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Come on, you'll even pray or go to church on Easter or Christmas. You even showed up tonight in this place, but I want you to know something. Lukewarm isn't just that kind of a relationship. Lukewarm is all your heart and all your life. He's first and foremost to everything. You live your life around what he is, not what you are. And may I say this to you? A lot of people don't understand that, but it's so simple to see. And so many people walk in lukewarm relationship with God. Well, here at the Rock Church, we refuse to let you get away with that. We refuse because we love you too much to not present you with the truth. You've got to get out of that lukewarm and get into a fire relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's there that you receive the blessings. It's there that you get eternal life. It's there that you get the Holy Spirit. It's there when you're in love with God with all of your heart. And it starts with you making the commitment of giving God all of your heart and all of your life. So here we are tonight. We have laughed. Here we are tonight. We have sung songs. Here we are tonight. God's touched you. You listened to the word of God and you received it well. You were great doing what you did tonight. But here you are tonight. Don't walk out of this place the same. Walk out of this place different, with a relationship with God that's deep and meaningful, because you gave God all of your heart and you gave God all of your life. You're probably wanting to know, how do I do that, Pastor Jim? How do I give God all of my heart? And how do I give God all of my life? Well, let's do it his way. Let's don't do it your way or my way. Let's do it his way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, listen to it again. If you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. He says, it goes on. He says, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. In a moment, I'm gonna do something. I'm gonna count to three. I'm gonna go like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm gonna go bang and pop my Bible. Just that sound. Bang. And at that moment, all of you that are walking, you know, little in, little out, little up, little down, all of you that haven't given God all of your heart and haven't given God all of your life, all of you who know who he is in your head, of course you know who he is in your head. You wouldn't be here tonight, but you haven't yet given him all of your heart and all of your life. All of you that are there, guess what? I go, bang, your hand goes up. I'll see your hand. Let me count your hand and then put it right back down. How simple is that? You say, wait a minute, Pastor. Hold on. Are you kidding? You want me to raise my hand? I'll be embarrassed. The people I came with will see me. The people behind me will see me. I'll feel funny if I raise my hand. I can't raise my hand. Oh, yes, you can. Get over it. Because it's better to feel funny for a moment in a safe place like this, isn't it? Than to be in hell forever and ever, because you care more about what people think and see instead of what God sees. Come on, no one's that dumb, but the devil's trying to talk you out of it. Don't listen to him. And tonight, I want you to get your hand up and put it right back down. Tonight is your night. Did you know that you have a divine appointment? Divine meaning God. Guess what? You have an appointment with God, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Oh my goodness. You've had a lot of appointments in your life. You had doctor appointments and dentist appointments. You've had attorney appointments and plumbers and carpenter appointments and car appointments and tire appointments. But tonight you have an appointment with God. God brought you here tonight. This is your night of salvation. And all you have to do is get past yourself and say, I admit it, I need God. And in a moment you get your hand up. Who should raise your hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, never given him all of your life, come on, come on, hey, I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are not sure, make sure, get your hand up. Maybe you're one of those people that prayed with Billy Graham on television or maybe prayed at a Harvest Crusade, but guess what? It's not a job, just a prayer that gets you in heaven. It's about your heart. God reads your heart. It's not the words that you say that are the right, perfect words. It's the heart that he's looking for. And tonight is your night of salvation. I'm gonna count to three and pop my Bible. Here we go. And you get your hand up. Let me see it and then put it right back down. Are you ready? Here it is, all across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, all across this place, wherever you're at, even in the foyer by television, if you're watching out in the foyer, I'm gonna pound my Bible, get your hand up and tell an usher out there and you can come in. Here it is, ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands. There's one, thank you. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, thank you. Eight, nine, 10, thank you. Back over here, 11, thank you. God bless you. Back over here, is that a hand? No, that's, oh, there's another hand. There's 12, there's some back up on top. There's 13 back over here. There's 14, thank you. God bless you. Anybody else, real quick. Anybody else want to give their heart and life to Jesus? Hey, I didn't embarrass them, I won't embarrass you. There's 14 of you already. Anybody else, real quick? There's another one there pointing back here wherever you're at. I think I already counted you, but I love numbers. I'll count you twice, 15. Anybody else? Don't miss this. If you're saying to yourself, I wish you'd shut up. I'm speaking to you. If you're saying to yourself, I'm not sure if I should. I'm speaking to you. There's 14 or 15 people. Get ready. Anybody else, real quick? Anybody else? Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 14 to 15 of you. Thank God for you. Here's what I want you to do. All 15 of you that gave your hand, put your hand up, want to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. You don't get saved by raising your hand. Please, it doesn't work that way. I wish it was that easy. I'm going to make you do something. I'm going to ask you to do something. You're going to have to do it in faith. If Jesus can walk a beaten, bloody mess for you down the streets of Golgotha, then Jesus, listen, if he can do that for you, you can walk a safe church aisle for him. And I want everybody in this room to nudge your neighbor and say, come on, if you need to go, I'll go with you. Just say those words. And I want all 14 or 15 of you, get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend, get your stuff, get out of your seat, get in the aisle, and meet me right here in front. If you raise your hand, you're serious about God, you come right now. I want you to get out of your seat and come. If you didn't raise your hand, you should have, you come too. Come on, let's stand and welcome them as they come.
Jesus, I believe.
Oh, they're coming. Give them a hand
Jesus,
as they come.
I belong.
Come on home. Come on home.
You're the reason that I live.
Come on home. Come on home.
That I breathe. Jesus. Jesus, I believe.
Come on, come on out of the family rooms if you need to. Come on.
Jesus, I belong to you.
Come on, give them a hand as they come. Come on, if you raise your hand, you're serious about God. You just come right now. Come on, come on. Get out of your seat and come.
Jesus, I believe.
Well, there's more of you that raised your hand than came, but I want you to know something. Listen, we love you, and we think you're wonderful, and we want you to come back and get right with God. Some of you need to come forward right now before we dismiss this group right here, and you're going to miss everything. You just need to get out of your seat and come right now while we're talking. It's okay. We just love you a whole lot. We'll wait for you just a moment. We have time for that. Is that okay? Is that okay? You just come. Just get out of your seat. Just say the people. This is not. You're not going to spill anybody's popcorn. You're not in a movie theater. You just get out of your seat and come. Come on. Come on. Anybody else that needs to come, you come. Come on. Yeah, come on. Come on, brother. Isn't God good? Well, thank you so much for coming. Oh, you guys are going to have to put a smile on your face. You're not going to the morgue. You get to go to heaven. Glory to God. You know, put a smile. This is a good thing, you know. Hey, I want you to look over to your left. See this guy over here? His name is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. No weird stuff goes on. I promise you. You know how you go to church? You wonder if they're going to be weird. Only when Pastor Luke preaches on this weekend is it weird. The rest of us are cool. But so I want you just to go right over here with Pastor Joel. He'll lead you in a prayer, give you some information, tell you about how to get strong in Jesus. We're excited about the future. It's going to be great. So make a left turn, if you will, and follow Pastor Joel right over this way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.